Welcome to the Short and Sweet Masterclass on casting. Today we're going to hear from two of my very good friends. We're very lucky to have John Mildren and Beck Carrig here from Eye for Casting and the Audition Room. And I'm just going to read you a very brief statement so that we know what Eye for Casting is. Eye for Casting's been casting as a team since 2004 and have done a great body of work specializing in television commercials, both domestic and overseas, as well as some TV shows and features. They've cast award-winning domestic and offshore TV and know the ins and outs of the Australian film industry. Eye for Casting can present online casting via their purpose-built web presentation system that is fast, efficient, effective, and user-friendly. In other words, it's really good for agencies that are working with them. The product that they deliver is the kind of product that their clients want to get, so it makes it easy for you to get work as well. Working with them, they know how to deliver their product out to the production companies. Well, that's great. So we've got two people here today. We've got the lovely Beck Carrig.
Hello.
Beck trained as an actor for 3 years full-time at the Australian Academy of Dramatic Art, and she knew from the end of the first year that she wanted to work behind the camera. From there, she decided to finish her acting studies in order to help her break into casting. Once she graduated, she went into full-time work in film production. After working in production for 2 years and getting to know the understandings of the film industry, she made the move to casting. She started working at the audition room at Eye for Casting in 2004,
and
2008, and was in 2010 was very pleased to be made a partner of the audition room. She continues to cast TVCs, that's television commercials, and anything else that comes along for Eye for Casting as a casting associate. She's busily building her showreel with Eye for and working towards being recognized as a casting director by the end of 2011. And Mr. John Mildren. In the mid-80s, John earned his degree in communications from Adelaide University with double major in script writing and film and TV production. In 1993, he moved to Adelaide from Adelaide to Sydney when he was accepted into the full-time acting course at NIDA. In the mid-90s, while working as an actor, John started Reactor. I don't know if anybody of you are familiar with Reactor. No, Reactor used to...
There's one person who is.
Yeah, well... Reactor was around for a long time and helped a lot of people get started. This led to managing prototype casting in the early 2000s, and then he turned prototype casting into Eye for Casting and also opened the audition room at Fox Studios. John manages both of these businesses concurrently. Aside from casting, one of John's greatest career achievements is as the pioneer of online casting sessions for actors auditioning for overseas production companies, primarily those located in Los Angeles. So that's really the key here, is the business. It's a great business for Australia, but it's a great way for Australian actors to get shown in the rest of the world. And that's, I think, what makes your business a success.
Yeah.
So I've invited them here, and we're really lucky to have them. And they're going to talk to us about what's important in casting. So if you could give them a warm welcome.
Look, the way, if it's okay with you, Cindy, we'd like to approach today is that... we're going to chat about certain like bullet points and things about casting, et cetera, but rather than have, if it's okay with you, rather than have questions at the end, I'd actually prefer it if people just ask questions as we go along. I find that usually more productive in these scenarios, these sort of chats, because if you think of something, you can ask it straight away and rather than sort of hold on to it till the end. So, okay, so I'll give you a bit, so you can know what type of questions you can ask us. I'll give you a bit... I'll expand a little on the type of things that you may want to know about, and then I'll start talking about casting specifically. What we do now, as opposed to the stuff that Cindy was talking about before, is our day-to-day, literally today, we've literally just rushed from the middle of a casting, we're here, and then we have to go back and finish the casting today. We do a range of stuff. We do everything from the most lame tomato soup commercial you could possibly imagine. This is with iForecasting. There are two businesses here we're talking about. Through to the online casting stuff that Cindy was talking about. That is specifically, and it's pilot season. You know what that means at the moment over in America? They're getting all their new shows ready and that type of thing. And in the old days, actors who wanted to be put up, Australian actors who wanted to be put up for pilots, the process used to be one of two things. You'd either have to just get on the plane. First of all, you'd have to have an agent that could actually connect you over there before you left, unless you were really brave. then what you would have to do is you'd have to get on a plane and go over, or shoot your scenes, or shoot some sort of demo reel for yourself on, I don't know, probably pre-DVD days, VHS. Probably pay for a PAL to NTSC transfer, and then international shipping, cross the, and send that across for every single job you wanted to go for. Okay. Now, thankfully, it's a lot easier. We started this about, seven, 8 years ago, in the very early days of being able to trust that people on the other side of the pond could actually watch video online and that type of thing. But it's progressed since we started off doing a couple of those tests for Shanahan's actors who, like people like your David Wenhams, who might have been doing a job here and still wanted to test for pilot stuff overseas but couldn't get on a plane and go over. So we would, Dave would come into us, we'd shoot the scene, we'd work the scene with him in the room, shoot it, put it online, and then LA have got it literally within an hour. So I'm just explaining that a little bit. It's different to real-time casting online, which is where you've actually got clients watching in real-time at the other end. That doesn't happen a whole lot. Usually because in the initial pass, when they're actually looking for people in pilot season, for example, they'll look at however many. It could be 20 at the very bottom number through to 2,000 people for a particular role. And then what will happen is if they want to see more of David, for example, they'd get David to come back, usually for a second time to see us, with notes from the other end at LA as to what they want from the pilot. And he'd come back and see us. We'd shoot it again, put it online again. And then usually that's the point when they fly the person over, the actor over to LA to see if they've actually got the job. That's happened zillions of times. We'd literally do, I don't know, between 1,000 and 2,500 of those a year. That's my primary job, is sort of overseeing that. Beck does those jobs as well. And we've done everyone from Sam Worthington did his avatar test with us, Mia Wasikowska, Alice in Wonderland, the list goes on and on and on, before they get flown over. And you know, so that's what we mean by online casting. I've also taught acting for many years, so I do actually understand acting theory. I usually work from a Laban base, if that makes sense to anyone in the room, I'm not sure. So if you have any acting in relation to casting questions, you can also ask those as well. That would be absolutely fine. So pretty much, yes.
So when, like, David Wenham or Mia Wasikowska is working with you guys, have you contacted their agents?
Okay,
or, like,
I'll explain how that pilot process works.
Sure.
So usually what happens is that there's a project, say it's Alice in Wonderland. Yep, that's not actually a pilot, that's actually a feature, but same thing. The brief will go out to the agents in Sydney as to the type of actor they're looking for. You know, Tim Burton's looking for X. And then primarily it's the upper range agents that have actually information to that brief, like your Shanahan's, RGM's, Lisa Mann, C-Money, those type of agents. Then the brief of what they want, the sides, which is the parts of the script, get sent to the agent. In this, if it was Mia, it would be still with RGM. Yes. So Mia's with RGM, which is an agency. So the script goes there, they give it to Mia, RGM ring us, so Mia's coming in for a Tim Burton film, Mia comes.
A lot of them have American representation as well, though. So.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's all part of the process as well. So if Mia then gets to the stage where she's going over, Shanahan's have already got a deal with another agency over there that looks after Mia's US interests.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how that sort of... that process worked. Did that answer the question?
Yeah.
Yes. So, pulling it all back a bit, would it be safe to work on the assumption, in terms of what's actually going to be of benefit to you guys, to assume that there are some people who have never been to a casting? Great. Yeah, great. So, let's whittle it all back now and actually talk about the basics of casting. I'll start off by talking about the food chain. Many of you in this room will probably already know this, but I'll just rip through it so that I don't start talking about things further that I haven't actually referenced to start with. Okay, let's go back to that tomato soup commercial. Yeah? So the industry food chain is what I'm talking about here, about when a job starts all the way to when a job finishes. So let's say we've got Heinz doing a commercial. They're what we would call the client, yeah, the ultimate client, the actual people who pay all the bills. They employ next in the chain advertising agency to actually write the campaign that they want to actually produce. Then the advertising agency, sometimes it can also be the production agency, but there's usually a separate production agency that the advertising agency employs to shoot the commercial, right? You're following this? Yep. Then the production company employs casting people to actually find that person. And then the casting person, us, we send out the brief of the job to all the agents in Sydney. Now, with a soup commercial, this is where the politics gets quite interesting sometimes, because, you know, certain actors at the upper echelon agents may or may not be interested in doing soup commercials. And if they do, they want a bloody lot of money for it, right? So there's politics involved in terms of what agents actually get that brief for that soup commercial. Because we already know, just through knowing the agents, that certain people, for example, Mia right now, who's not even here, I don't think she's back in Sydney. She actually lives in Canberra. But she's probably not going to be, you know, it's no point in actually asking for Mia to do a soup commercial. And plus, you can actually have issues there with agents that will ask for a certain amount of money for their actors if they already have a profile. So it all comes down to how much the agency who are doing the soup commercial want a certain type of... Do they want a profile person doing the commercial? Or are they looking for a good actor and they don't care about profile? Which is often where actors can get their break on those sort of jobs, where, you know, what they really want is they need performance. Yep, they actually need you to sell down the barrel that you're just wild about Heinz and believe it. And the agency don't want to pay for someone who's got a profile. Yeah, that can actually be a very practical way as to how an actor gets their first break. It's not the only way, but it's one of them. And so we send out the brief to those agents. And if they're looking for an actor who hasn't got a profile and they've only got $5,000 to $8,000 to pay that actor to do a fairly high-profile soup commercial, then that's when we might pitch the ad to what we would refer to as the mid-range agents, and so maybe even underneath that. And it's our job to try and find the actors that are with those agents, particularly the lower-range agents, who have some diamonds in the rough. Yeah?
What are some examples that you would use of the mid-range agents?
I don't want to get too specific. It's just that it's a very political thing, and it's actually when actors come to us, unless you're a very good friend of mine, and say, I need, you know, what's this agent like, or blah, 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 it's actually politically incorrect in my business to actually answer that question. Mm-hmm. Having said that, keep asking questions like that.
Okay, I will.
Great. Because as Cindy knows, I'm not backwards and coming forwards, and I'll give you the ugly truth about anything you want to know about being an actor trying to break in, yeah?
Well, going back to that then.
Yep.
Third tier, would that be extras agencies then?
Or? Yeah, yeah. No, probably you've got... You might... Look, this is just John speaking. It's not as if there's a casting industry handbook on this. Mm. But, you know, you would think of your top tier agents, your mid-range. Top tiers, there's probably... What do you reckon, Ben? Six?
Six.
Yep. Then mid-range, there's probably...
10.
Yeah. And then lower range, it changes all the time. Yeah. But, you know, you could be looking at 15, 20.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, there's more at the
now,
point.
Some of those lower range agents have extra agencies attached to them. Yep.
Then there's some agents that just specialise in extras.
Just
but
extras.
That's not to say with... we will still go... We will still put the brief out to extras agents if... And because a lot of the time we know certain extras and stuff and we know that they'd be good for the brief, so we still send it to them as well.
So we send out the brief. We then, as I've said, going back to the food chain, call the agent. Agent sends the actors in. And what goes in the process then, in the casting process, which I'll talk in more detail about in a moment, is then in the process, certain actors get selected from the the herd that you've seen initially. Once again, I'm thinking about commercials here, not drama. And then they might have 20 selects of people that they want for the soup commercial. We recall those actors back, and then usually the director or the producer or both or more people are actually in the casting studio when you come back for the recall, and then you get the job. Yeah.
Do you limit in the initial round when you send the briefs out to the agents and they send in their suggestions? I mean, obviously you must have a cap. You don't see everybody who's submitted by their agent.
Because we've only got. Well, the studio. How much studio time we have is a huge issue, and also because it costs money because we have to hire the studio. So, yeah, like we might only have. We generally see about between 10 and 15, but generally about 12 people for each role for a TV commercial. So we have to choose really carefully. If you think your age, like you've got to be careful if you think you're not going for castings, you've got to be careful that you don't just assume your agent's not working for you, because your agent could be submitting you for everything and you might just not be getting to the casting. It's not always the agent that's stopping you.
Yeah, I think agents have a hideous job because they're caught between us and the actors.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And the actor always thinks that they're not putting them up for stuff. They could be putting you up for everything.
And
us fuckers are here going,
nah.
Pardon my French, everybody. I swear a lot. I'm sorry about that.
We all swear.
Yeah, if you're in casting, you swear. Yes, mate.
Having said that, say 10 to 15 that you've picked, Showcast books. When was the last time you guys used
Oh, we use Showcast constantly.
Only online, though.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, the days of getting the book out.
Yep.
Unless your internet's down. That's the only time that you use
it. And obviously, casting agents have their preference. 82, Showcast, E-cast. So is there
Everyone does, yeah. But we use Showcast and 82. We don't really use E-caster at our office, but I know a lot of casting directors that do. So everyone's got their own.
Showcast can be particularly interesting, particularly helpful for not singling you out, but ethnic types, looking
That's
for that type of thing. There we go.
If you come from a marginalised community with an ethnic type or disabilities, is it better to go to an agency that specialises in that or try and go into the general mix?
I would say probably go to a specialist agent if one exists for whatever it is you're talking about.
Yeah.
For example, black people, often there's coffee-coloured characters.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
They don't do Afro-Caribbean or Afro-American, I rang them.
Yeah.
And then there's an Asian agency and there's an Aboriginal agency.
Yep. But if it's something, you know, this is like, and this is where, I'm going to come back to your point, but I just want to segue for a minute. This is where it gets very politically incorrect in casting, because people get cut up into little packages. I hate to tell you this, but I'm just being honest with you. It's true. And it's not because, a lot of casting, not all, but a lot of casting people don't understand acting like we do. So we understand that you actually could be Prince William if you really wanted to be, if we're looking for a Prince William lookalike or whatever. I understand the process of acting and that's the way it should be, but the bad news is it's just not that way. I'm talking about commercials, okay? So a client, that I was talking about before, Heinz, or not usually Heinz, but the ad exec agency or whatever, they're not bothered. We could talk to them till they're blue in the face and say, I know you personally, you're a really good actor. You could actually do this even though you look completely wrong for the role. And 95 times out of 100, they're not going to wear it. They just go, no. Yeah? So, and that for us can be really frustrating. Of course, because we know it's our job to know as many actors in New South Wales as we possibly can, and through the two businesses, if you've been around long enough, we know you. And I might know that you can actually do whatever it is they're looking for, even though they don't think you can. But in commercial land, yes.
Would it be of any benefit if a girl was sweet looking in a headshot with blonde, beautiful hair, and then she went under a different name, perhaps with punk brunette look?
More specifically, so what's the brief we're talking about here? What are the client looking for? In the scenario...
Just putting yourself on Showcast.
Are you just saying like
you mean
more
different
than
looks?
One?
Yeah, different looks.
Oh,
but
okay.
Usually one headshot per person, isn't it?
We're going to know. We're just going to know.
But the casting person, I mean the client, might see
our
the headshot
client,
list.
You mean?
Yeah, Heinz might see go through the headshots?
No, they don't see it. Only we do.
It's kind of, we're kind of, that's our job, is to be the filter.
Yeah.
So do you check out all the, because I've got four on mine, so you check out all the different...
You're talking Showcast?
For each, but yeah, for both. And
Yeah, we would see that. Absolutely. So that's a possibility.
And Showroom?
And sorry?
Showroom?
No.
Yeah, no, give you a word about, hold on to your questions because we're going to get there, I promise. Showreel, really, you can put them up on you know, Showcast, etc., that type of thing. Yeah, sometimes, not a lot, but it's always, my best advice for you as an actor is to have your DVDs are dead, by the way. Please don't send DVDs.
Send an online link via email, because this is so lame, but it's true. In casting, there's no time ever to do anything. It's actually quicker to click on a link and press play than it is to get a DVD out, put it in, and work out who the person is that you're watching.
Not to mention, store the DVD somewhere, find it, go and put it into the player. I know that doesn't sound like much effort, but when you're looking at hundreds of people, you know, when you can just go click. Yeah. So get your showreel online.
And when you send the email, don't put your photo as an attachment, like just little things like this. Don't put your photo as an attachment. Put your photo in the body of the email. So when we open up the email, there you are. And then, because that's going to grab us if we like your look, we'll go, maybe I'll just click on this link.
Or even better, have a page made up that has your template on it and links your showreel scenes.
Yeah.
So that if you find out through Cindy or someone that there's, you know, she's found out from me that we're looking for, or maybe we're looking for, what nationality, what's your background?
Asian Pacific.
Okay, Asian Pacific with a disability.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you've heard that we're looking for that. We told you a while ago we were looking for a specific thing that you weren't quite right for.
Yeah.
Please don't repeat what it was we were looking for. But you might hear that, and if you've got your showreel ready to go online, and I don't mind, no one would mind at all if you just email us and go, I've heard you're looking for this, here I am.
Right.
Okay, do not write a 10-page email telling us your life story. And do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just, here I am, click the link. That's the best way you can get our attention. Yeah.
Is there any such thing as a freelance actor?
Yeah.
Yeah, there is.
And is it a lot of work to manage your own affairs? Like,
it's harder to get seen because, you know, the briefs don't always go to the freelance actors. Once we meet a freelancer, if they're good, we just remember them. Or there's actors that have had agents and then they go freelance and we know who they are, so we get them in. But, yeah, it's definitely harder if you're freelance.
And I would be very careful. And but in Showcast online, you see it's all searchable, which really helps the freelancers.
Yeah.
Now, if we're looking for a specific type, you know, 45, dark hair, wears glasses, thin, you know, then, you know... So it helps the freelancer. Where it gets really dangerous for you, however, is when you get the job.
Right. What happens?
Because you're open to it. And honestly, I have to say, most of the time, there's not a lot of exploitation. It's much better than it used to be. But you are open to exploitation in terms of being paid, in terms of rollovers. Do you know what rollovers are?
Yeah, when
the something is sold overseas. And it's...
Yeah, so say you do the soup commercial that we're talking about, and it's in the contract... that you that soup commercial is only going to be paid for 3 months, and it's only going to be played in New South Wales. Then, if it's really successful in New South Wales and it goes national, or it goes online, or God forbid it goes to America, which wouldn't happen from an Australian commercial. But that means you need to get paid a lot more money.
Yeah.
You know, if you're a freelancer.
And if you've signed your deal memo and you haven't given yourself enough money, then that's it.
And it's not the casting. That was a little part I left out of the... Yeah. So we don't pay you. You actually get paid by the client, right? So it's not our job to find out if your job's rolled over, right? So it's actually your agent's job.
Or yours if you're freelance.
And that can be hellishly difficult, keeping track of that.
Just going back to showreels... What's your idea of the perfect format of a showreel?
Do you mean web format? Or
content, like how many...
Okay, cool. I would say... And are we talking about an established actor or someone who's trying to crack? Get in.
Both.
Okay, so for a professional actor, it's fairly easy. They would need to have the best of their dialect work, if they've got good US stuff, like I was working with... What's his name?
Tim.
who's doing Dance Academy, a series here, but he's also done Wolverine and the movie and blah, blah, blah. So I was talking to him about that today, and I said, okay, the Wolverine stuff, look, it's shit as far as acting's concerned. We all know it. I'm not saying it's a bad film. I'm just saying this is not something that has great moments of pathos. Yep. But I said, Tim, you've got to have some of the Wolverine stuff in to show your US accent and that you've done that sort of project. Then the better acting stuff was in the Australian series he's doing at the moment. You probably wouldn't put any commercials on. You certainly wouldn't mention extra work. Yeah. With the actor who's starting out, I would be very, very, very want to encourage you so much to be realistic about who you are. Okay? Because there's nothing worse than actually having an actor with a 10-8, a headshot, who looks, 23 and has long flowing hair and turns out to be 94 and black when she turns up. Do you know what I mean? Nothing against black. But if we're looking at someone who's blonde and blue-eyed, you're looking... Do you know what I mean? Yeah. So women, you know, I'm being sexist, but women often make that mistake the most. Simply because... Yeah.
It's like what they do on dating sites.
Yeah, it's the same thing, There is absolutely no... Sorry, go on.
Just in the tape days, they would say fast forward was just sort of ground down. People just go fast forward.
Absolutely true.
Does that change in that, say, look, putting, say, 4, 5, 15-second sort of clips and then the longer ones at the end? Is there any... That's what I mean by format. Is there a format that you would...
Well, once again, that's why I asked you about web or DVD, because... You interact with those things in completely different ways.
Well, I don't think any of us between
DVDs and that. No. Well, but some people might not know that. So, but no, with the web, usually in the old days, what used to happen was you mix all of your various stuff that you've done, assuming you've got some professional work done or show, or even your own shot show reels and things. You do a lot of that, Paul. Yeah. So in the old days, you'd cut together all that stuff into one seamless, clip, and put it on a DVD. Now I would suggest exactly the opposite, that you actually, for a web format, you have your 10-8 and then you have clickable links to all the different scenes. So for that 10-second factor, which is real, if you on the web, if you had all that stuff cut into one long sequence that runs for 8 minutes, if they don't like the very first thing you see, it's over. However, if they are looking for an Asian guy who's fit, and from what I can tell, I'm 5'7", 5'8", and maybe they don't like the particular thing they see of you first, when they first click that first thing, they go, I don't like this piece, it's crap, but let's have a look at the next one. But that wouldn't have happened if it was all into one into one clip. So yeah, that 10-second factor is deadly real. Yeah. Thumbnails. Yeah, or if it's actually on a constructed web page, it's just a link that you click. Yeah. But going back to advice for people who are starting out in terms of when I was talking about know who you are, try and understand the market that you'll be pitching yourself towards. There are several ways to actually get a break. Like I said, one of them, and probably for people who haven't gone to NIDA or haven't gone through the more traditional steps, Lisa McCune was the Coles girl. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Yeah? She's a really good example of that. This is horrible, and as actors who take yourself seriously, I know this is so bloody depressing, what I'm saying right here is, but think of yourself in terms of the commercial market, okay? And present yourself that way. Don't try and... I hate saying this, I really hate saying this, but don't try and present yourself as a serious actor who has done Macbeth and Shakespeare and list about 500 theatre shows on their resume. That is almost a guaranteed way of not even clicking your link. Yeah? So it's not about having a long resume, which is not all crap. There's a lot of good stuff that's... In fact, most of the work you do as an actor that you really enjoy is actually stuff you don't get paid for. But I'm trying to give you pragmatic advice here. I'm not saying this is the way it should be. Yeah? Keep your resume clear. A couple of shows and things. And if you've done nothing, don't stress about it. Just say, I haven't done bloody anything. And then if we click the manufactured show reel that you've made for yourself, it'll be a nice surprise if you're halfway good.
And if you say you've done nothing, like when you come in for a commercial, That's fine. We actually go, yay, because we know there's going to be no stress. You've done nothing competitive. You're a nice, fresh face. That's what I always say. Nice, fresh face. Because some people kind of go, I haven't done anything. Don't say that. Just say it.
It's actually that's a great point. It's actually, when you're starting out, you often think, when they ask that question, the casting of what have you done, you know, what have you done? And people think it's a bad thing to say nothing.
It's not at all. It's the best,
what they want to hear. Because that means that in terms of commercial market we're talking about, still, drama is completely different, completely different. But, you know, we want to know that you haven't been seen, because then we found you.
So, I've done a lot of stuff, 1990s, it's best to forget about that rather than say I've been pre-dressed.
No, I'm talking about... I don't want to name any particular theatre company, so I'm going to make one up. There's no such thing as...
Juby.
Yeah, the Juby players.
Yeah, that's it.
Yep. No, I'm not talking about professional work at all.
Right, OK.
Yep. No, I'm referencing this for people who are trying to break in.
I can't remember the commercials I did, so...
Well, yeah, you don't... I mean, that for commercials, you don't have to say what you did in the 90s if it's now.
But police rescue, you know, drama, always list good drama stuff. Absolutely. No, absolutely. So, sorry, who else was...
Take it then, that you mean you've done lots of amateur shows,
don't mention
that, you've never done
commercial or professional. Oh, look, if you've done 30 amateur shows and 2 short films, pick the best 3 amateur shows, preferably the most recent.
And put the short films.
Yeah, and put the short films, absolutely.
Because you want to see that, like, they're experienced a bit and know what to do behind the camera as
absolutely.
Well, don't you?
Yep. Absolutely. And, you know, if you have, there are exceptions, but if you have any fantasies about, you know, you might be a really great actor, and I'm saying that seriously, but if you have any fantasies that you're going to go from that into the lead of a film, it's not going to happen.
Yeah.
There's, even for the most brilliant actor, I could give you thousands of well-known, Sam Worthington, there you go, there's one, who... Up until just before he did Avatar, just before James Cameron signed him up, we cast him in a little feature. And he was already well known, of course, by that stage, but he was still learning how to actually present well in front of the camera. And he's, you know, I'm not saying he's the world's greatest actor, he's a lovely guy and he's a very good actor. Mm-hmm. And he's doing extremely well known. God bless him. But the fact is that he's a really good actor and there's no shortcutting experience in front of the camera. Unless you're a freak. And that usually means a kid.
Yeah.
Or an animal.
Yeah, before you've learned all the bad habits.
Yeah, kids.
Yeah. So there are exceptions, but, you know, so you've got to be realistic about how to work your way up, you know, in terms of the thudding horror of having to do a super commercial or, you know, everyone walks around NIDA going, you know, when I graduate, I'll... Yeah, there's no way I'm doing soaps or super commercials. And after 3 years of eating dog food because you're at NIDA and you've got no money, the first thing they do is a commercial. A lot of the time.
And not for dog food, probably.
Well, probably not for dog food, no. So, yeah, yes.
Just a quick question about, like, 82 and things like that. Mm-hmm. How important is it to have a diverse range of photos on there, or is it just really 1, 2 is good?
One or two, I think.
Well, yep.
3 if you really want. I think that... Everyone should have a coloured photo.
Yep.
Like, it's the way, man. It's the way of the future. Like, it's so much better for us because we can see your skin tone, your hair, your colour of your eyes. It's you. And also, have your headshots done, you know, every 2 or 3 years. Don't have a 10-year-old photo because that happens all the time. And then it's just annoying because then we get you in for something that you're totally wrong for. Plus... It's actually doing you a disservice because you're getting sent to all these castings and you're looking around and there's like people that are 10 years younger than you and you're not going to get any roles. So, yeah, just make sure you keep your headshots updated and colour all the way. Thanks.
Do you do
these
on the show cast
page? Do you mean your... What do you mean?
I think that, you know, Mike, I'm sure he's talking about today. You should put those on the show cast.
Are you talking about, sorry, just the word DVD is confusing me. Are you talking about just referencing them on Showcast? Like, I've done Short and Sweet. Okay, I got the video on Showcast, yep. Yeah, no, absolutely.
I don't think you, I think you are responsible for doing that. I don't think your agent is responsible for doing that. So if
if
you want that done, you've got to organise that yourself.
But you know what, a lot of people are computer literate, like
yeah.
And I would love to have someone that could go, yeah, Cap, I'll take that little bit out of that film and put it on there.
That's when you come to the audition room.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
We can do all that for you.
There are a lot. Showreels
cost a fortune. I mean, I'll ask a showreel to be done, and they won't do a showreel just on its own unless they have like five other people that want, because they want their day's work to be worthwhile, and it does take a lot of time and effort to put into to make a showreel. So if they can get like five people, you know, that's a good day's income.
Mm, it depends for that company that you're talking about. Shop around. There's all sorts of people that do awesome.
How do you, you know?
Legwork. What's called?
Yeah.
Pick up the phone.
Not picking your brain?
Google. I've actually got a self-interest there because we do that. So I'm not here to pitch us though. So
we don't
actually, back in the reactor days, we did do manufactured showreels. Now, because we've actually learned, you know, that 10-second factor, just being on the other side for several years now, it's much more important to put you in front of a blue psych, you know, like a chroma key background. Yep, mm-hmm. They're using casting. And just show your acting.
Paul Barry.
Really good show. Really.
Yes, there we go.
Paul Barry. We always send people to
Paul Barry. Used to work for me for Reactor. He does them. He does the ones where he sits down and work with you and go through the acting and all that type of thing, which I used to, but I just don't have the time for anymore. So what we're talking about, what we do is you're ready. You come and see us. We shoot it. We put it on our webpage for you with your photo, blah, 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 blah. But in terms of spending a lot of time with you in terms of your craft, I just don't have time to do that anymore. Yeah. Yes?
I'm confused now as to the relationship between the actor, the agent, and casting, because what you're saying is the actors can approach the casting agents, the casting company, themselves, and does that then annoy the agent? You might also have been asked to...
So can you just repeat that?
Yes. There's the actor,
yes.
The agent,
yes.
The casting agent.
Yep. Absolutely, it shouldn't.
Yeah.
It shouldn't, but that all comes down to your individual relationship with your agent. To be honest, in some of the upper echelons of agencies, the agent would like to know before you do anything exactly what you're doing, because a mistake, when we're talking about jobs that could be millions of dollars, they want to know if you've got an idea about going to see a casting person without letting your agent know about it. The agent would want to know. However, if you're starting out and you've got a reputable lower range agent, it's highly likely there's going to be a conversation at the beginning of when you signed up with them where they'll go, here's a list of casting directors, I think you should try and get out and see them. Yep, so it depends on the agent, yeah? Yes?
What's the best way to familiarise yourself with casting directors and like, say if you've got representation, but then you've got, like, comp cards if you're doing modelling or something like that,
mm-hmm.
can you just email or mail them out to people, or would it be better to book an interview, or like what's the best time effective thing for everyone?
It's got like I love doing go sees, but it's so hard if we're busy. They just get put back and put back and put back and put back. Definitely don't send a hard package. Well, not for us anyway, we just don't keep anything like that. Just email and then ring to mm-hmm. see that we've received it, and then if you want to go see, like, just keep emailing, because it will happen. It's just it doesn't mean we're fobbing you off, it just means we actually are working so much that we just don't have any time to,
like, this year honestly at our office there's been someone there, usually you to start with, at 7 a.m. and there's usually someone there at 9 p.m. and we work weekends.
I've been doing 14-hour days, like,
and trying to squeeze in go season amongst that.
Can't do it.
But then you wait for that glorious occasion when you have like a dead 2 weeks, and then you might get all of a sudden, can you come and see us tomorrow?
Uh-huh.
It will happen. I've got like a special email folder with people that have emailed with go sees, and I will make sure they come in because it's really important. And also, it's really important for us to meet new people and see what you can do and everything like that. So do it.
Mm-hmm. Thank
do you prefer that approach to come from the actor or from the agent?
Either way.
Either way.
What was the question?
If I go see, what that is where, when you're new and you actually come in and meet the casting people. Either way is fine. It also depends, to be honest, upon with our relationship, because we're just like everybody else. We have different relationships with different people. Some agents we're really close with, and if they go, you need to see this person, then we'll go, okay, bring them in tomorrow.
Yeah, but also keep in mind that this is just us saying what we like. There are casting directors that don't do go-sees, and there are casting directors that don't appreciate emails reminding them of people who they are, you know. So,
and along that line,
you kind of get the vibe.
Okay.
Exactly as Beck said, this is not according to the casting handbook. This is our opinion.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
But I've managed to get a bit of work on my own accord without the agent. What is the protocol or the policy or the politics of that? Does the agent, should you tell your agent, look, I managed to get this role in a feature film, and if I managed to get it by word of mouth and through a friend, do I go to the agency and say, hey?
Yeah.
Yeah. Once again, sorry to be grey on you there. It does depend on the relationship that you have with the agent. I had a low-range agent at one point. This is back when I was acting. And I had an extremely good relationship with her. And so if that was me, then I'd go, absolutely, and she'd be thrilled. You know, some other agents might be intimidated by that.
I still think you should tell them because I think that it could cause friction if you didn't tell them.
They do look after your contracts and the legalities of... And it can be an absolute, like, trying to keep track of everything is an absolute business.
Oh, it's a nightmare.
Business.
Yeah, absolutely.
And
yeah,
I would love, to have that and just say, you know what?
Great piece of advice with agents is almost regardless of where they fit on that sort of plane that we were talking about before, most important thing is to have a good relationship with your agent. Even if they're supposedly a bit lower on the pecking order, doesn't matter. Have a good relationship with your agent, yes.
Do you do much theatre casting?
No. That is a really disappointing thing, that there's just...
No money.
It's such a closed shop. I'm sorry to tell you this. In terms of professional theatre in Sydney, in the country, it's I hate saying this, but it's pretty much a closed shop. Sydney Theatre Company did a really good thing 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago where they had opens. Yeah, you could go and have auditions and that type of thing. And once again, there are always exceptions to the rule, but pretty much, because it's hard enough for people who graduate from NIDA or VCA or WAPA to actually get work, naturally the industry tends to look to them in terms of theatre work. And it's also a practical reason as well, because in terms of real stagecraft, which is not easy to learn, and does require training, I don't care what you say, I'll say that as an absolute definite. Yep, there's no one who just walks onto the stage and knows how to do it. There are people who have an innate skill with camera, more so sometimes, yep. But because it is such a defined skill, the stage, and because the actors of NIDA, VCA, WAPA, et cetera, obviously are finely crafted with their theatre skills, it makes commercial artistic sense and just wisdom to actually search in that pool first. And that is, I'm sorry to be so depressing, but that is kind of how it works. There are exceptions.
So just on that point, and if you don't do it, probably it's a silly question, but imagine that you do. What sort of things would you be looking for from a theatre actor?
Imagine that you do what, sorry?
Imagine that you're cast in the theatre. Mm-hmm. You know, there'd be quite a few people here going for non-professional theatre jobs.
Mm-hmm.
Not paying. What would you be looking for a theatre role over a TV role? Are there any particular sort of things that you might like to see your experience with?
What, as the person casting, what the difference in what they're looking for in a role that's for theatre, as opposed to it's a role that's for film or TV? The skill set.
It's completely different, isn't it?
Yeah, the skill set. Yeah, it's all about, we're segueing to a different type of conversation here because you're talking about performance maybe, and at the end of the day it's all about truth. Am I losing you here? Yeah, so there is a difference in terms of how you pitch the performance, in my opinion, between camera and stage, but at the end of the day it's all about truth. Yeah, even the most ridiculous comedy of I don't know, who's really over the top and truthful. You know, Seinfeld and all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If they weren't really taking it seriously and really telling the truth in their performance, you wouldn't find it funny. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But to go back more specifically to your question, the skill set, in my opinion, just my opinion. But if I was, because I've spent more time professionally in the theatre than I have in front of the camera as an actor, a lot more. And so I understand the audition process really well. And what they're looking for is the skill set. They are looking for the voice. You know, they're looking for the presence to be able to command a space. Yep. Whereas and with camera, to be more specific for you, it's about when we're here and the actor being able to understand that they only have to think it and it reads.
So, when you cast a film, you know, this saying, you know, 80% of the work is under the casting director.
Yep.
Okay. Is there a big difference between, all right, this, I'm going to get this good-looking person, that that's their natural character for that role, you know, they can enunciate well.
Are we talking about film or...
We're talking about film.
Yep.
And that may not segue very well into theatre.
Oh, yeah, hell yeah. I'm not going to, but I could tell you a whole lot of really well-known Australian actors who would fall apart on stage. Absolutely. And that doesn't mean they're not a good actor. It's their different skill sets. Yeah. Yes?
Going back to go sees and stuff like that, if you're lucky enough to come and visit you guys for castings a few times,
mm-hmm.
would you still need a go see, like to see what I'm capable of or anything like that?
No.
You've already made
we don't get you to act at a go see. We actually... You know, hopefully you'll have a reel for that so we can see that. It's actually a casting person's job to have an innate under... I'm actually shithouse at most things in my life. Absolutely hopeless. But the only thing I am pretty damn good at is actually looking at someone and actually not being able to tell your whole range as an actor in a heartbeat or anything, but generally I can tell... what sort of presence you have, both in terms of stage and camera, and stage is not, unfortunately, that important to me these days, in terms of looking at actors, but understanding it's just a sense.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, everybody's wrong all the time, but that's what we use go-sees for, to try and sniff your essence. That sounds awful.
That sounds yummy.
You know what I mean.
That's true.
Do I? So, you know. Yes.
Thank you.
Sorry? When you're actually in the room, that's a good segue to another...
No, that's not... She's talking about before we even... Like, when we choose
the... How do you get some... How do you get...
Yeah. The headshot. It's also us
once we've met you, we know you.
That's go sees. So...
And being on shortcast as the black person with a disability, that because there's a search function there.
I don't mind. We're cool.
I'm a big.
I'm a Morgan Man in Ice Bridge.
Yeah, I'm 120 kilogram poof. You know. So that's the thing about casting. It can just seem so wrong that you actually. It's quite blunt, but that's the way you have to talk when you're looking for certain types.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And. Then
yeah, it's all about. To answer your question, if we don't know you, it's all about type.
There are castings, like I just did a casting where I saw over 500 people. And so that's where you might get your break because we might go, we need to see 500 people because that's what the client said. So I'm going to get every bloody person in that I don't know that looks okay in their photo, and then you might come in and I might be like, shit, yeah, you're awesome. And then you might come in for other stuff from then on. That happened last week. There's people now that I know that I know can do more than I ever would have known they could do. But because we just did like a blanket casting, now all these people are going to come in all the time for us.
And it's a cliche, but it's true. You always get the jobs. The jobs that you get are always because of the jobs you didn't get.
Mm-hmm.
Never a truer word said in casting. Yeah? So don't be disheartened when you go for that soup commercial and you know.
Yeah, because you'll come in, like if you did well, you'll come in again for us again and again and again and again. So, yeah.
And again, it starts from agencies. Sorry, last time. So it starts from agencies. That's how you first get to see us.
Yeah, or searching through through the online version of Showcast.
So you'll only see people who have
agencies.
No.
If you ring and do a go see, we'll know you.
Sorry, I was just about to point at someone and was it you? Sorry.
Just to clarify, I've paid a year for my free digital showcase.
Yeah.
Are you saying that I have to be responsible for putting the DVD in for it? Doesn't my agent do that?
No.
I don't know. Funny, that's what this group should be for. Theoretically, shouldn't it?
Yeah, you should, I'm sure someone...
The agent.
No, you send it to Showcase.
And it is worth. I have no financial interest in Showcast, but it, if you're trying to crack it into the market, it's worth that money every year.
Not ET2.
Oh no, both. Both are good.
But you pay additional. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you do. Yeah. Yep. So sorry. Was there someone?
The opposite of what you're saying. Is it of any value to have theatre footage?
No, absolutely not, under no circumstances.
Discard it.
Because you can't get the essence of theatre anyway.
Theatre does not translate to being videoed.
Mm-hmm.
You already know that, don't you?
I have realised that over many years.
Haven't you all got that show that was actually great when you were in the room?
And you look and you go, oh.
But there are times when I would be applying for theatre jobs. Why not have it all in one location? Separate.
Have a special theatre one if you... No. I don't think so. I think you just have to go in there.
Camera is camera. Do you know what I mean? I already know that. I mean, I haven't seen you for years. Well, aside from, you know, every now and then. But I already know that from the stuff you put on Facebook, which was something we haven't talked about. You know, you understand innately, Paul, what is a camera performance and why that you wouldn't actually show yourself in a theatre show and put a lot of that on Facebook. Because it could be a great theatre performance, but it's shit online.
Mm.
Yeah? So, yeah, because they're different skill sets, like I said before.
What about putting a performance on YouTube? Because there's a lot of people that have done that.
A theatre performance?
No, camera work.
I reckon that's silly.
Like a bit of self-publicity. There's the, I think it's IDMB or something. What's it called?
IMDB.
But that's for, like, isn't that for professional stuff? Mm. Like, I think it's a bit silly to put just...
I disagree with you a little there. I think if you're lost in the fucking wilderness and you don't know how to, do you know what I mean? You're doing all the things that we're talking about. Because at the end of the day, you understand it's a numbers game. Yep. Then if you're going to get some notoriety by riding a pony naked in you know, in...
Oh, that's different. I want to see that. I thought you meant, like, acting.
Do you know, I think the net is fantastic in the possibilities that it can be for that freakish person who just taps a nerve. Do you know what I mean? But for every person that does that, there's 100,000 wankers who are riding around naked on a pony.
I find that...
Is it possible? I think it is, yeah.
If you put a monologue online and you say what the monologue's from, people who are interested in studying that monologue will find you and probably rate and comment as well.
Yeah. It is, and it's possible if you get enough people liking you, blah, blah, blah. Then like, actually, this guy is a really good example. I don't know the specifics, but there was that mashup that you did at the end of Q&A. You know the TV program Q&A?
Yeah.
Paul did one of those mashups just before the election of Tony and Julia singing.
Yes.
To each other. Yeah, sure.
And then I bet, I don't know, but I would imagine the amount of hits that you had probably multiplied by a lot.
Well, it was more on TV. 900,000 viewers, but I bet about 20,000... online.
I rest my case. I
mean,
on TV, mate.
No.
YouTube
I'm talking about
well.
Getting noticed. I'm sorry. We're talking about different things.
Yeah.
Here.
But I'm talking
getting
about
noticed.
Putting your acting stuff on there is not gonna. I don't think that's gonna.
No. But
anything.
It's the same theory with reality TV, with Big Brother or whatever. You know, we've got Big Brother people in for castings before who've got work. Yep. So it's the same sort of principle.
But I can tell people I made that. People recognise me, and I'm that guy. Now I'm more important than somebody who's not known. When I talk to somebody in production.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is there are no casting directors sitting around.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Nice.
Gee, I hope I can find...
No. But my point is there's no casting director in the world that hasn't heard of Susan Boyle.
Super.
Absolutely. So I'm saying in terms of it's possible. Am I suggesting you'll go out and do it? Absolutely not. I'm just saying that it's possible to get because all you need to do is to get, not us, you know, we're just one of a pile. You need to get casting people into their brain and think of, and for them to think of you as something. Mm. And it's possible to do that through that medium is what I'm saying. And then you get called in for casting and Bob's your uncle. Yeah.
What about local work? Is it the same process?
Local work? Yep. Yep. You mean online? Yeah, we do bizarrely, we do all sorts of work, like who was it with Marquee? He got a role in the David Williamson's The Removalist that was just on Interstate.
Oh,
doesn't matter. Bizarrely enough, after having said what I said about performing theatre performances on camera, he came in, did a theatre performance of the role that he was going for because he couldn't get interstate to the auditions. It was just bizarre that professionally I'd done the opposite role that was reading him with him.
Alan Plough?
No. What's his name?
He's a grad.
He only graduated out of school.
From Whopper.
Out of one of the schools. Doesn't matter.
I can't remember.
But he got the job. So, yeah, but so we do, yes. It's not very common because most of the time it's $75 to get a flight to Melbourne and, you know, if you want to test for something. But we do all sorts of weird things online, not just. But primarily, I'd say 95% of what we do goes to LA. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's such a shame for the theatre, only because they shoot on the theatre short and sweet. But if I'm casting for my own place, it is just so good to see, to go skipping through all these pieces, connect actor act.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, one, you can just go, are they right?
Mm-hmm.
And then see this audition.
That's always the first question. Yeah. Are they right for the role? Yeah.
Are they the right age? And then you can see that they're actually acting, not just, you know, some close up in a frame and they're acting in some TV drama. But I find it really good. I mean, I can understand as a sort of agent or a casting agent, you're going to do that, you're going to do it from a different angle. But
you do.
But it's really good to see those 10-minute pieces.
I honestly know what you mean, because I remember, you know, when I was back here and the idealism that you have, and I don't want to sound like a jaded old poof, but you have, and I still hold on to that in terms of taking the craft seriously, understanding that it is a craft that deserves respect, which actors just don't get. I swear to God, I treat every actor that we come across with respect, whether they're with, I don't want to name any agents, but the lowest of the lowest agent or the highest of the highest, it makes no difference to me. Because acting is a craft. What will cause me not to respect an actor will be if they think it's just a matter of walking in and I can act and I've never had any training. Yeah, do you know what I mean? That gives you the scream of shits. But if I can see someone's really taking it seriously, even if they haven't had any experience, and they have a drive, because I remember what that's like, you know, but then I have to counterbalance that against the pragmatism of casting, you know, and the fact that there's only so many seconds in the day, you know, so, yeah.
What is the process you go through in your selecting for your roles? How many applications do you get for a role?
What do you mean by process?
Like, you said I can just suss you out, like.
Oh, well, pretty much, in terms of commercials, a lot of this, very rarely are the decisions, sometimes the decisions aren't as. I mean, a lot of the time it goes to the client. Sometimes we can vet people out, but the process of selecting who gets shortcast, shortlisted and things is actually comes from the client above us.
Yeah. We so say who we think is really good, and they usually...
they select as well.
Yeah, and they're usually, like, pretty much on par with the director, but sometimes they're totally different. Like, you'll be like, no, it's got to be this person, and it's not.
Yeah, that's commercials. Drama is completely different.
Yeah.
How often are you wrong when you say, you've got this person and they look great and you've casted them? And
we're talking commercials or drama?
Oh, I don't know.
It's important. Don't notice it.
Drama.
Okay. Yep.
Yeah. And... they found on set to be sort of wooden, or they did that role, but we needed you in this other scene, and they couldn't sort of function that. How?
It happens, absolutely.
With drama, though, it's pretty rare that you get to that stage isn't it?
Yeah.
That you get to the stage where...
It happens all the time in commercials.
Yeah.
You can think someone was hot, really good performance in front of the camera, hasn't had any experience, there's a find, oh my God, we were the first person in Sydney to find this actor, we're thrilled, they're going to get the role, and the client back comes back and said, no, their tits are too small. Do you know what I mean? It can drive you fucking crazy. But with drama, wrong, less so.
But it's pretty rare that they get that either drama or TV, commercials or TV, that they get on set and then they're crap. Like, because they'd have to go through...
That's what the process is for.
Like, I think there's only been one time that I've worked, that there's been a person that was crap on set and they got canned.
What do you mean crap on set? Do you mean on camera or...
They were just...
As a worker on
yeah,
set?
Yeah, they were...
No,
they were crap as an actor. They just weren't very good.
They were terrible on camera.
Which therefore means it's probably a nerve issue.
Yeah.
Once you've got the crew, you're not just in a little studio in a casting studio, you've got the crew there, poor bugger probably just internally collapses.
And it was bizarre. But that's really rare.
Because they must have had some ability to actually get...
And they'd gone to the recall and the, you know, so they'd done all the steps, met the client.
Sorry, you've been waiting, yeah.
Can I just ask in terms of... Oh, sorry. In terms of you said Walker and is there other like university degrees that are okay as well to do, or they're just like crap?
Okay. Beck's probably got her own perspective on this. I would answer this question honestly by saying I'm gonna give this, like, I never have children, but if I had a kid who was going into the business, I would advise that if, you know, numbers game that I talked about, you just know the sheer chances of making a lifelong living out of this, and it's not always about money, but if it is, that if you're going to spend 3-4 years of your life studying the craft, and even if you go to NIDA, VCA, Whopper, there's not a great chance you're going to spend the rest of your life doing it and making money out of it. Even if you go to those schools, practically speaking, I would say, if you audition for those schools, and there's the main three, we all know there's the main three in Australia, right? And if you don't get it, but don't audition just once. That's a huge mistake everybody makes. Audition time. If you start auditioning and you've auditioned 4 times for each of those schools and you don't get in, I would suggest that you don't go to a place that can't connect you as well into the industry. That's a hideously pragmatic thing to say, because that is making the assumption that other places don't understand the craft and can't teach acting. That's bullshit. There are lots of great places. The Actors Centre is great. Do you know what I mean?
A lot of them have the same teachers. It's just the reputation.
The other universities like Wollongong or whatever, they might just go on numbers and you just...
Well, it's just the numbers game. It's how well they... And you can do your own research into this. Yeah. How well does place X connect you into the industry?
Yeah.
Yep, I'm answering that question like it's. I'm saying that to my son or daughter who wants to get into acting. Yep, and that's the pragmatic side of me. The other side of me hates me for saying that. Sorry, mommy. Yeah.
You said sending everyone off to LA. Does that mean everyone that you see has to have an American accent?
Yeah, if you're even thinking about getting into professional arena, get a good US accent, better than the one I've got. So,
because. Who do you suggest? Any names? Bill Pepper?
Yeah, Bill's great.
Lorena Bellis?
Sorry?
Lorena Bellis?
Yeah, and there's also this other lady called Paige... is that Paige Walker? She got red, short hair?
Yeah.
She's great. She's really great.
The reason we kind of look at each other searchingly at that question is because I've been out of the business of teaching acting for a long time now, and I'm not really connected. I mean, I know Bill's great. do you know what I mean? But
Paige is really good. Yeah. Paige
now, sorry, who was it? It was you. Sorry.
If I do the perfect showreel scenario for you, so I've got 4 links.
Yep.
I'd say I've done a couple of professional commercials.
Yep.
Are you happy for the drama stuff? Well, I haven't done any
professional drama.
Professional drama.
Yep.
Are you happy for that to be stuff I've shot to camera, for example?
Absolutely.
So
if I said anything that implied otherwise...
No, I just wanted to clear it up.
Oh, absolutely. Because everyone's got to start somewhere. Okay. We know that don't forget, we want to find the people that nobody else has found. You know what I mean? That's our kudos.
And you're talking, you said, I know I'm going to how long is a piece of string, but you'd say four clickable links of about 30 seconds each.
Yeah, look, if you've got 10 pieces up there,
no,
right.
Yeah, yeah, four's great, so I
four
reckon.
And about
30 seconds.
That's a great sort of scenario.
I'd say minimum two.
Or two to
max.
3 minutes.
Yeah. Oh, and if it's stuff you shot yourself, it's just one camera, yep. Don't worry about doing a big edited job. It just doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I used to think it did when I made them for people, but it just doesn't.
So do you go from comedy to drama to whatever?
As long as the performance is truthful, any of the above, yeah. But what I would do, really take my advice here, no longer than a minute, quarter. So, and I know that's really depressing, but if you have a great piece that's 2:15, cut it down to 1:45. Okay, and I know you often think that how can I cut it down to 1:45? They might know the piece, and I know that I haven't actually.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Oh, please get over yourself. It's not like that. We don't care. We want to see someone who's acting well. Yeah. Or actually not acting. Yeah.
Can I just ask you something else? I heard that Sam Worthington got the part, that his showreel ended up on an American casting agent's desk or something, and the thing that clinched the things getting back in is he said a few words, turned around, went, and he spat.
I don't know, because after our process, he went over to LA. I assume you're talking about something that happened in LA. I don't know.
And then they took another 3 months to convince James Cameron that he was box office material.
Well, I do know that he was on a contract where he was basically paid to, which is, these are great, these contracts. They pay you squillions of thousands of dollars a month to actually do nothing while they decide if they want you or not. And that's the reason he couldn't do the feature that we had cast him in. He actually wasn't doing anything, and he couldn't do the feature that we cast him
but
in.
But it's just a matter of, like, you would have to have the reputation of having done a lot of work beforehand. But what I'm saying is that if James Cameron turns around and says, you know, I like the way he spat and just said those few words, that really, really stood out to me.
Yep.
That is the clincher.
I would, ridiculous as it sounds, Tim, I'm cutting his reel together for
Tim
him. Tim Pocock. He's got a lot of professional stuff and I'm putting it together, Wolverine, blah, 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 that I was talking about before. He had these scenes that were really meaty stuff, that was, you know, battling scenes, physical stuff, non-physical stuff that's just really in your face, which you think would be really fascinating moments. And then we had about 8 scenes he wanted me to have a look at that he wasn't sure about. And one of those had a moment when he was just sitting with a girl on a picnic rug in one of these scenes. And they just shot each other a look. And he was so in the moment and so in the pocket, just in that little tiny moment. I said, Tim, that, in my opinion, that is the moment that gets you jobs.
Because when we go to the Actors' Centre and we go to the drop-in, when I go to the drop-in classes, are you familiar with Lewis Fitzgerald?
No, I'm sorry.
He used to start as Ivo in Flying Doctors, and he's done Pitch Black with Vin Diesel and all these other credits that he's got up his sleeve. He always stops the camera and he says, you see that? He goes, that's what I'm looking for.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just an absolute thousandth of a second moment.
I would completely agree.
That is what people are waiting to see. That little bit of look or that emotion.
Yep.
Yeah,
and I know this is really frustrating. It's not about having the big... It can be. You can have great moments in argy-bargy scenes. Or you can have great moments when you've just been told that your mother's died. But generally speaking, they are not the scenes that impress. And if you're a female, please don't think that crying is good acting. it's the tiny little moments. It's the moment of making a choice on a particular beat or line, whatever you want to call it, that nobody else has made. They're the moments that get you work. You know? Whereas, because I don't want to get too far into acting theory, we're running out of time, I'm sorry. Oh, yep. Okay, so do we have to stop?
No, we've got 5 minutes.
Okay. So when you're preparing your work, this is the best little piece of acting advice I could give you is when you're separating your beats, whatever you want to call it, and you're working on how you're going to pitch everything. If you're always going with your first choice, she says, you know, go to hell, and then I'm going to play an action to blast her there, tick, moving on to the next beat, you're not doing your job. The most interesting moments are the moments where you find a motivation within their character that's a bit of a kink on what's actually just written on the page and finding a truthful way of pursuing that.
So is it always like on the showreel when you present a showreel and say you pick the best moments that you can out of your film work to present? Like, it might be just 2 seconds.
No, that would be ridiculous. But you have that scene there that contains that moment, absolutely. Yeah.
You need everything around it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
You know how some kids are photogenic by themselves naturally?
Kids?
Yeah, kids are.
Yep.
But how about adults? Adults are not generally photogenic. They need to be photogenic.
I disagree. Sam keeps coming out in conversation. Sam in the room, I don't know if any of you have met him, he's quite a small guy. He's not very tall. He's kind of got that red hair and freckles complexion, looks a bit gangly at times. Put him in front of the camera, bang. You know, and it's not makeup, and it's not it's not special effects. It's just it's
it
yeah, absolutely. You know, yeah. So
it's not photogenic, genicness. It's the presence of the person.
Absolutely, which is kind of that X factor thing. Mm-hmm. We've got a couple of minutes left. Is anyone burning to ask something that we haven't covered? But, yes.
Real life personality. Do you switch it on into I'm an actor mode? When you get into Steve, people
casting.
Like you.
God, no.
What about with Americans?
No.
Always
no, being no, real. No, no. You can smell it a mile off. Don't ever walk in being desperate to get the job either. You can smell it a mile off. You have to be prepared professionally as an actor. You want to take this seriously. I've done my prep. I'm here to have a good time. Here, how are you? You know, but if you minute... That's the reason that in these chats, and I haven't done one of these for a while, but I just have the approach of I'm going in being me, I'll swear my head off, I'll admit to being a 200-pound gorilla poof, and do you know what I mean? And it's about being yourself. Yep, and there is something that people actually know is true when you're being yourself, and you need to bring that into the room at a casting. If you try and be something you're not, it's over just the second you've walked in, truly. Because we need to get to know you, we need to be able to trust that we can recommend you to our client, going, yeah, but if we just kind of got this white noise thing going all the time, then no.
So you wouldn't come in as dressed like if you're going to be cast in Tarzan and Jane, you came in as Jane.
No, absolutely. You wear something indicative.
Little skin, little thing around your groin. That's
yeah, no. You wear something indicative of the role that you're going for, yeah? If it's something extreme, like, well, if there's any nudity involved, your agent will advise you before you get to the casting anyway, as long as you go to a reputable casting. But if there's, say, it's a panda suit or something, no, that's not a good example. Something extreme, then you'd be wise to ask your agent, should I go as far as wearing, like, an Indian outfit, say, somewhere where you can see your face, yeah? So, like, a big Indian-like outfit. Should I go to that length or ask your agent? They'll ask us, we'll give them some advice, you know. So, but, yes.
Professor, how much time or how prepared are you to fight for the person that you've chosen to get to the...
In terms of drama, it can be in the whole process with drama, it can be a battle. It can be, if you really believe in someone, if they don't get the job, then you hope that they'll get called in for something else that they will get. In commercials, it's sorry, no. Yeah. I know that person's right for the role. I don't do commercials, actually. Beck would actually know the answer to that question much better than me. But in commercials, if their client says no, even though you think they're perfect for the role.
Last week, we actually fought for two in a commercial, and we got them in. But it's hard.
You're the professionals. I had this at a workshop a few weeks ago where it was the casting director of the ABC, and she even had to negotiate with directors once they pick somebody.
Oh, yeah, and there's all sorts of things, like it can be not to do with talent, it can be to do with availability and just all sorts of things.
It can seriously be like, oh, the director, that director doesn't like his cousin and the person looks like his cousin in a commercial. Oh, well, I don't like my cousin, she's a bitch, so no. Like, this girl's not going to be in it.
Who's this?
The appetite for
talent. No, drives you crazy.
It's rare that you'll get a client that's really...
It's not just commercials. If you're talking big Hollywood films, the people that often make the decisions, they have no idea either. So it depends on the type of project you're talking about. But, you know. So, last one.
Before you said when people are going to LA, the brave ones who might not have
a
decision, they just get on the plane.
Yeah.
What would their plan of attack be, the best plan of attack?
Okay, unless... Are we talking about the brave ones that just go over?
Yeah.
Oh, I haven't done it. I'm not sure. I don't know how... I honestly...
Yeah.
you really, my honest advice is that you need to have an agent on this end that has some sort of American connection. Because you're just opening yourself to horror beyond horror.
Yeah, no, that's...
I'm wincing because I'm just even
thinking about it.
Do you know what I mean? Like,
no.
It would be true to say that most people get a presence in Australia and then they leave.
No. Used to be. That's changed in the last 5 years. It is really possible if you've caught the eye of an agent who thinks you're really interesting, that agent, because the world has shrunk so much lately, that agent has a deal with Raw, who's an agency in LA. They go, this guy's great. Raw goes, okay, let's see him do a few tests. And so it happens quite a lot that people actually get work over there before they get work here.
Yeah.
That didn't used to be the case.
Like you're saying,
because they come and see us, we put them online. Okay. Do you know what I mean? That person no longer has to fly over to LA. And they can see them doing a range of different castings, you know, of different drama projects. And they, because Marquee here recommended them, and they go, oh, yeah, I see what you're talking about. And then the agency over there knows this person from the test they've done with us. And they go, okay, I know who this guy is now. I know what jobs to put him up for here in LA. And so it goes. But that's really only the last 5 years or so. Online casting has made it a lot easier for people who are breaking in, as long as they're good. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about Facebook, as you mentioned before? We'll
make that the last question. Okay. Going to be short then. I'm not... nothing more than what I said before, really. In terms of... It's a way of pitching yourself, absolutely. If you can find that magic way of getting a lot of hits and somehow getting a bit of a ball behind, a momentum behind you, so a lot of people are seeing it, it only needs one of those people to be a casting person, you know. I mean, I saw your thing on Q&A, the mashup you did, and the next day I think I emailed you through Facebook and said, Paul, that was really good. You've got talent there in that area. If I were you, I would pursue that hard and now. Paul actually did a video, like edited to get like a mashup. Do you know what a mashup is? It's editing. Quick description of mashup.
I just took two faces, Julie Gillard and Tony Abbott, and then put my mouth through their faces and sung.
Yeah. In fact, it's not even really a mashup, but it doesn't matter. And that was on Q&A, and a lot of people liked it because it was really good. And then. Paul had that also as a link on his Facebook page. People go to that page, they see it, and, you know, and let's hope Paul can, not only through that, but other ways can, you know, do well.
Great. All right, well, we'd like to thank John and Beck for coming in to speak to us.
Thank you.